There's been a bunch of teams that relocated throughout the course of NBA history. In recent times, the Seattle Supersonics' relocation to Oklahoma City was the most well-known and the most controversial. It's clear that a ton of fans in Seattle want their team back because the way they lost it left a bad taste in their mouths. However, what about the Vancouver Grizzlies? They also lost their team and saw them relocate to Memphis, where they started to have a lot more success. How's it going, fellas? My name's Andy, and today we're going to take a look at the Vancouver Grizzlies. How did they lose their team after just 6 years of being in Vancouver? First, I'm going to give y'all a quick background on the Vancouver Grizzlies. Back in 1995, the NBA was looking to expand the league outside of America and into Canada. The two cities they decided on were Toronto and Vancouver, two very populated cities in Canada. While both franchises started off really slow, losing a ton of games, the Raptors were always a step ahead of the Grizzlies when it came to basketball influence in their area. In their first seasons as an official NBA team, the Raptors were third in the league in attendance, while the Grizzlies were 14th, according to ESPN. But as the years went by, the separation would grow even wider. The Raptors quickly gained a ton of popularity, mainly because of Vinsanity. Carter catapulted the Raptors into fame and fortune, as he helped the team lead the NBA in attendance for three straight seasons in the early 2000s. But unfortunately, that was not the case with the Grizzlies. After just six seasons in Vancouver, the team was forced to relocate, and as y'all know, they ended up in Memphis. So what happened to cause all of this? Well, it was a combination of different factors. The biggest reason was that the team was losing a lot and they did not have a legit franchise player. The best player that they had who could have been considered as a borderline all-star was Sharif Abdur-Rahim, who averaged over 20 points a game for a couple seasons there, and he was overall a pretty versatile power forward, who's been forgotten over the years. And he would make an all-star team later in his career. However, he wasn't helping them win games, and neither was anybody else they picked up from the expansion draft. In the franchise's first four seasons, the team actually had a decent attendance record. Not as good as Toronto's, obviously, but they were around the middle of the pack, 14th or 17th in the league, somewhere around there. But in the 1999-2000 and 2000-2001 seasons, their last two seasons in Vancouver, they were third worst in attendance for both years, averaging about 13,000 fans every game. Of course, the low attendance rates translated to lower revenue. But I mean, that's not a huge deal. There's been a lot of teams over the years that saw their attendance plummet if their team is losing, but they usually don't have to relocate. But the thing is, with the Vancouver Grizzlies, the revenue loss extended way beyond just the lower fan attendance. John McCaw Jr. was the owner of the team from 1995 to 1999, as well as the Vancouver Canucks. However, the operating costs were way too high. And the Canadian dollar was pretty weak, so it just wasn't profitable for him to own a team in the area. So he was forced to sell both the Grizzlies and the Canucks. Also, the fact that John McCaw Jr. was based in Seattle did not help his situation. A lot of local businesses in Vancouver did not want to support the Grizzlies because it wasn't owned by someone who was local. McCaw ended up selling the team to Chicago businessman Michael Heisley for $160 million in 2000. The Grizzlies under Heisley's ownership did not do any better. As I mentioned earlier, in 2000 and 2001, the Grizzlies saw their attendance drop significantly and continue to lose games. According to Dick Versace, the president of basketball operations for the Grizzlies, the team reportedly lost about $80 million in 2 years. That figure seems ridiculous, but if you look at the bigger picture, it could be possible. The team struggled to get corporate sponsors, and when they did, they weren't worth much anyway because the team was still losing a lot and they had no all-stars to market. The NBA didn't really promote basketball in Vancouver as much as they should have either. Granted, the team itself did have some solid players like Big Country Brian Reeves and Mike Bibby, and I guess Sharif Abdur-Rahim was their best player, but he was obviously not a household name either. They did not have a single member of their team make an All-Star game in the six seasons in Vancouver. Additionally, very few players actually wanted to move to Vancouver in the first place. The most prominent example was Steve Francis. The Grizzlies drafted him with the second overall pick in the 1999 NBA draft, but he did not want to play in Vancouver. Francis publicly stated that he did not like the city and he did not want to move to Canada. An incident at the Vancouver airport where some random people thought he was a rapper was the final straw. So he publicly demanded a trade and he would not play for them, so the Grizzlies were forced to trade him. This was devastating for Vancouver. Francis was an exciting player with a ton of charisma, and that was what the team needed at the time. They needed him to reignite the franchise, attract more fans to the games, and help the team win games. The fact that he was the number 2 pick and refused to even play for the city, that severely destroyed the rest of Vancouver's hopes of keeping the team there. Not surprisingly, every time Francis played in Vancouver as a member of the Rockets, he would hear relentless boos from the crowd. According to an interview with Sharif Abdur-Rahim years later, he recalls the last game they played in Vancouver. It was April 14th, 2001. The game nearly sold out with over 18,000 fans in attendance. While normally a game like this would be filled with energy and excitement, or at least something because it was the last time the team would play there. But Abdur-Rahim said that, quote, "I remember it being like an eerie energy. I had never experienced that before. It was energetic and emotional and kind of eerie at the same time." Apparently, there was a fan that was holding up a sign that said, "Thanks for the worst team ever." I know one fan should not represent the fanbase as a whole, but I'm sure many other fans felt the same way too, and did not care that the team was leaving. Even today, the team barely left any sort of legacy in Vancouver. It was almost like they were never even there, and the 6 years of Vancouver Grizzlies history have been forgotten. It's not like Seattle, where there's still a ton of people who still care about losing their team, and a ton of former players have been vocal about getting a team in Seattle again. Now, don't get me wrong, Vancouver is an amazing city. While I'm sure there are tons of fans in Vancouver who still want their NBA team again, unfortunately, there aren't any plans to get a new team anytime soon. Anyway, the Vancouver Grizzlies ended their reign of dominance with a total record of 101 wins and 359 losses. Zero All-Star selections, a couple of bad draft picks, and yeah. It's hard to find a bright spot, but at least the city experienced what it was like to have an NBA team. I'm sure there's still a ton of older basketball fans in Vancouver who wish they never left and are still upset they're gone. Michael Heisley, the owner, had a number of potential locations to relocate the team, which included St. Louis, Louisville, Las Vegas, New York, Anaheim, and San Diego. But they ultimately decided on Memphis because they made a strong bid and the city had a huge wave of fan support and interest in basketball. And that sums up the story of the Vancouver Grizzlies. For those who were able to watch some of their games back in the day, what was your favorite memory? Let me know in the comments. Thank you everyone so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video, and as always, I'll see you next time. Peace.